one mic.
All I need is one mic.
It's just different.
One mic with Big Mike.
The overall tenor of what he's saying is very stupid.
And they say his style is too urban for the radio.
Maybe it's not racism. Maybe it's placism.
Brother has to know his place, right, Bob?
One mic with Big Mike.
Things aren't always what they seem.
A sports talk show, but no subject matter is off limit.
Don't just tell me that the reason something's being done is because that's the way it's always been done. Because the first thing I'm going to say to you is slavery.
And now, your host.
I got the big homie here who needs no introduction.
Big Mike. Mike.
All I need is one mic.
Welcome, welcome, welcome to a Friday edition of the One Mic with Big Mike show with me, your host, Big Mike, right here on Spreaker.com. I'm also on the Spreaker app, so make sure you go ahead and download that for your mobile device. I'm saying Spreaker, S-P-R-E-A-K-E-R. I'm also live on TuneIn and, of course, my website, OneMicWithBigMike.com, spelled the number one, M-I-C-W-I-T-H-B-I-G-M-I-K-E. If you don't get a chance to stick around for the entire show, I know it's Friday. I know some of y'all want to have your date nights and all that kind of stuff. If you don't get a chance to stick around for the entire show, you guys can also catch the show on demand on each and every outlet that I've already mentioned, as well as on iTunes, iHeartRadio, Stitcher, Google Play Music, and YouTube, where you're able to catch not only the audio, but, brace yourselves, the video. Yes, I'm streaming live video right now on my Facebook page, Facebook Live. It's going on right now at One Mic with Big Mike. So make sure you head on over there, like the page. Also, make sure you follow me on Twitter and Instagram at the number one, MICWITHBIGMIKE. If you want to get involved in the show, we got a pretty decent show for you MFers tonight, man, for a Friday. We ain't really done the big things that we do usually on a Friday, but we're trying to step the game up a little bit. So this Friday show should be a little bit of fun. With all the goings on this week, we gotta close this thing out right, man. So if you want to be a part of the show, text me at 404-902-8104. You can also jump inside the live interactive chat room like the big homie Big L has. What up to you, homie? To do that, you got to be listening via Spreaker. You got to be listening via my website, onemicwithbigmike.com. And when you see the little thought bubble icon on that little streaming player, just click on that, and a couple steps later, you'll be inside the live interactive chat room where you guys can interact with me. You can interact with whoever else is in there. A couple days ago, one of the homies told me to mind my damn business and get back to talking on this damn microphone. So, you know, it ain't really a lot of politeness that you got to have. You just got to come on in here and do your damn thing. Do whatever you want to do, man. Also, you can leave your comments below the live video stream, like I mentioned earlier, on Facebook. You can leave your comments below the live video stream. If you got a comment on anything that I'm saying, you want to ask a question to my guests, have me pass on the message. I'll try to if I can. But, you know, yeah, tonight's going to be a nice night, I think. We'll watch it just bomb. tonight at 7:30 at the bottom of the hour, if you're listening to the podcast, if you're listening on demand and not live, at the bottom of the hour, we're going to talk to the big homie, Shaun Smith. Shaun Smith is a former NFL D tackle. He made some waves. He made a few waves over like his playing career, but here lately, he's made some waves for admitting to actually smoking the ganja, the wacky tobacco, cannabis, chronic, before playing in NFL games. And before you guys are like, oh, what? Before you guys hit yourselves in the head with that, listen to the interview, man. Because we got some stuff that we want to talk to you guys about why not only is that probably not even a bad thing, but why it's probably a good thing. And then at the top of the hour, one of the friends of the show, the homie DJ Rasta Root, DJ, manager, friend of the iconic hip-hop group A Tribe Called Quest. If you guys hadn't heard, they're going to be on Saturday Night Live this Saturday, hosted by Dave Chappelle. So Dave Chappelle has come out of exile to do this, so it must be a big deal. Got a brand new album out today. Name of the album is... I'm sorry. Why didn't I write that somewhere where I could just see it quickly? Oh, thank you for your service. Nope, excuse me. Back it up. Put it in reverse. We Got It From Here. Thank You For Your Service is the name of the album. It's out today, 16 tracks. I hadn't heard it yet, but I'm going to go ahead and cop it so that tomorrow morning when I get my my workout out in the morning, that's what I'm going to be working out to. I'm going to be working out to the all-new Tribe Called Quest. They did this album in secrecy, man. And then, of course, you know, the homie Fife Dog passed away earlier this year, but they still had enough to put the album together. So highly anticipated, man. For all you heads, man, you hip-hop heads, man, straight up, it's gonna be a cool night. Rasta Root is a cool dude. If you ain't hear my previous interview with him in July, you can still go back, get it. It's still there. I think it was like on July 8th or something like that, but it's in one of my previous episodes. I mean, he's a real cool dude. Hit him up at the last minute. He was like, no problem, homie, let's do it. And so we're gonna talk to him at the top of the hour. Then at the bottom of the next hour, we got to move on this day, my daily feature, all the way back to the bottom of the next hour, because as you can see, we're double fisting this damn thing again tonight with the guests, so it's a good thing. What up? I am No Doze. You just stepped in the building. I was just talking about you. Yeah, I couldn't remember who it was that told me to mind my damn business and get back to talking, but now I do remember. It was you. So, again, the chat room is wide open. The text line is wide open. Even the comments below the live streaming video on the Facebook situation is there for you. Also, we got a question of the day today. And I've been effing these question of the days up because I'm an idiot, first and foremost. And I know what I want to say. And then here's the problem. Renee, you guys know Renee helps me produce the show. But it's come to the point now where, as any good producer is, like, she knows how I think. And that's usually a good thing, but it's a bad thing because, again, I'm an idiot. So I want to say certain things, and I say, Renee, this is what I want the question of the day to be. And she'll know what I mean, but then I read it later, and I'm like, that's not kind of the vibe I wanted. So today's question of the day has to do with 7th Streeter. If you guys remember, 7th Streeter was pulled from singing the national anthem at the Sixers game last week, week four last, whatever. They gave her this, you know, BS apology and all this kind of, because she had on a We Matter jersey, and they weren't trying to hear that. So, of course, social media outrage hit them. They changed it up on them, and now she's coming back. They're invited back. So my question of the day, the way it should have been phrased is, what level of pettiness would you love to see 7th Streeter exemplify when she goes out the next time at the 76ers game and does the anthem? Like, for example, I've got like a whole plan that I would love to see enacted. Like, her and like whatever the biggest, blackest choir there is, go get them. And everybody has like huge afros, dressed in all black with black Colin Kaepernick jerseys and like black gloves on. And then she sings the anthem, all of them, but she sings it like laying flat on her back with a fist raised. Like, that's the level of pettiness that would be acceptable and funny as hell for me after they tried to stunt on this damn girl. So that's the question of the day, brought to us by sportsnewsandbrews.com. You guys can answer it in the chat room. To get there, be listening via Spreaker, the Spreaker app, or, of course, one mic with bigmike.com. And on the streaming player, you'll see a little thought bubble icon. Just click on that. Make sure you guys are signing up for your free Spreaker accounts as well. It's free, like I just mentioned. Just like, you know, whatever. Chat, what is it? Snapchat and Instagram and all this kind of stuff is free. Just sign up and follow me on Spreaker. Follow my show, One Mic with Big Mike. That way, when the show goes live every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, you guys get an alert telling you it's time to rock and roll. That Big L, I am No Doze. Y'all get the alert? Because Big L was here, like, right on time. You know what I mean? Yep. See? Yeah, I am No Doze. See, this is why I mess with this cat, because he's right around my brand of ignorance. An F. Trump t-shirt with a laughing emoji. FaceTime 4. Anyway, I was asking you idiots if you get an alert when when the show goes live. Because I don't know if it works for everybody or how it works or whatever. They just tell me that's what happens. You're supposed to get an alert. So text the show at 404-902-8104 if you don't want to jump in the live interactive chat room. And you can also leave your comments below the video on my Facebook page, One Mic with Big Mike. And make sure you like the situation while you're there. Before I go any further, man, shout out to the vets. It's Veterans Day, and I'm one who said many times before. Shout out to Emmett Bean. Emmett Bean said the Georgia Mass Choir. That's a big choir. Yeah, have them come out there. Emmett Bean, check me out on the Facebook stream. But shout out to the vets, man. I'm one who always, as much as I can possibly can. And today is a good day. We were talking about marijuana and weed and all this kind of stuff. It fits into a lot of things that the veterans in this country go through. You know what I mean? I think the number, if I'm not mistaken, is something like 22 vets a day, I think, commit suicide, man, from PTSD related issues, man. That's a horrible, horrible thing. Vets have to be homeless. They're not getting the proper medical care. The VA system is crap. Like, these are things that's real. These are things that are way realer than a big ass flag covering a football field, or a bunch of MFers, you know, lining up in attention at a basketball game with saluting, and you standing up at the basketball. This is way bigger than that. Like, dudes is dying and families are being ripped apart. Like, cats is living like hermits because they can't leave the house. They're so traumatized from PTSD. The government, a lot of dudes are finding that marijuana, that weed, what we're going to talk about a little bit later on with the homie Shaun Smith, weed helps the PTSD. But here's the thing. The government will pump these cats full of whatever kind of antidepressants, antipsychotics, anything, right? But then test them for weed. Because then if they get caught smoking weed, they strip them of all their other VA benefits. How you love that? Yeah, America the beautiful, America the great, right? Yeah, so on days like this, like Veterans Day, like, it's cool to be like, thank you for your service and for protecting me. Like, I don't thank them cats for that. I'm going to keep it real with y'all. I don't. The reason I thank veterans is because they have a different mindset than I do. Them cats that volunteer to go to harm's way. Like, I'm from Decatur, so when, like, people start shooting or there's a fire, we instinctively run the other way. You understand? So dudes who have that gene in them that says, you know, I'm running to the trouble, by all means, man, appreciate you. I ain't even BSing, because the day, like, all y'all was lying about I'm leaving the country or Donald Trump become president, yeah, all you MFers are still here. But the day they start talking about drafting N-words again, I'm out. You can't send me nowhere to fight for this damn country. Nowhere. You can't even send me across the street. Talking about fighting for America? Nah, I'm out. I'll be living in, I don't know, some other place. Quickly. You know what else should be the question of the day? I wonder how many of you dudes and ladies, how much would it take for you to leave America? Like, not that Donald Trump is president, because a lot of people can say, I want to leave, but not a lot of people are financially in a position where they could just drop everything and bounce and start over in another country. But, like, if you could get, like, I don't know, what is it, like a GoFundMe, like, how much money would it take for you to be like, I'm out, be in Brazil or somewhere, or Spain or somewhere? I think if I got like half a mil, maybe quarter of a mil, I'd pack up and just bounce. Yeah, I ain't trying to be here. I've told y'all many times, I just stay here. they drop my folks off, and yeah, it wasn't no way to get nowhere else, so we just here. You feel me? So yeah, that could be like a bonus question of the day. Like, how much would you need if you would even leave? You know, Donald Trump is president now. People think things about to get real rough. If you got some color, if you got some melanin in your skin, things about to go real digital for you here in just a second. What else we got today? Because I ain't talk about no sports on Wednesday. I ain't, he's right about that. I ain't gonna front. I know those is like, he coming with the realness. Ain't too many places that would like our black asses. This is so true. And you look, not even Africa, because you want to know why? If you ever talk to an African person, tell them that you're an African-American. They're like, a what? Are you African or you're American? Because I'm African. What the hell is that what you're talking about? Yeah, dude, he's right. I'm sure there's somewhere that'd be better, like France or some one of these, you know, liberal places. But, you know, they get blew up like every 6 months. Like the ISIS cats love these Frenchmen, dude. They love to F with them because, jeez. Oh, Emmett, like, see, now everybody got a reason for not leaving. And Emmett being, my English is too good to leave. I don't know what the hell that means. Like, if I don't talk to nobody in America, but the people I mess with and y'all, yeah, the language barrier wouldn't be no problem for me. Everywhere I got McDonald's, I eat McDonald's till I figure it out. You know, till I figure out what the, you know, what the cult, the customs is. I give me some Rosetta Stone, I got 250 grand or 500. I buy me a Rosetta Stone in 6 months, be fluent in whatever language I want. Oh, these cats, yeah, see, now these cats got their own conversation going on. Talking about the GI Bill and all this kind of stuff. Shout out to your boy Danny. Danny's over there in Italy serving the country, man. So y'all, Danny's listening or watching me on Facebook. So if you guys get a chance to, man, shout out my man Danny, man. He's overseas. Say he's coming home in just a second, but yeah. Maybe you might want to change those plans, Danny. We got some stuff going on over here right now. The Reagan years all over again. Big L said it's the Reagan years. Because that's AIDS and crack. That's like Reaganomics, AIDS and crack. That's what we're running with right now, man. Woo. Oh, Donald, you orange bastard. You MF-er. Jesus Christ. I'm supposed to be setting up my damn show, and I am messing with y'all. All right. Back on track. Back focus. The Braves made some moves for all my people here in Atlanta. I don't know how big they are. I'm not, you know, I don't do the baseball thing real heavy, but old fat-ass Bartolo Colon from the Mets is here on a one-year deal, and the knuckleballer, R.A. Dickey. If you've never heard R.A. Dickey's story, like his story coming up, man, it's like a heartbreaking story about this dude, man. Get a chance. You can Google it, and I think he wrote a book, too. You can Google it and read about it. Shout out to my people in Cali. I mentioned this on Wednesday when I was talking to the homie Guy Tory, but shout out to the people in Cali, Massachusetts, Nevada. All three states passed the legal, recreational marijuana. I think Florida and like two more states passed it for medical use. So, you know, shout out to them, man. Progressing, the country progressing and whatnot. We'll talk a little bit about the Hawks here in just a second. The Hawks making some moves, man. They're trying to grow up as a franchise a little bit. The new ownership is really, you know, trying to pump some money into the organization. Got a couple of little NBA things I want to hit as well. And, of course, we got another weekend of NFL football and college football. College football ain't going to really give you nothing this week. All you're really hoping for this week is upsets. And the only one that you really, really going to maybe get a chance of it is Iowa or Michigan going to Iowa. But other than that, had Thursday night football last night, allegedly. It was an alleged football game that took place last night. And I got this NCAA, the college basketball season started today. They're doing that, what is it called, the Veterans Classic, that where they play on that big-ass ocean liner, or what is it called, where they keep the planes and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah, they're doing that right now. I might not look at no more damn college basketball till March after this, because all the good-ass teams playing tonight, you feel me? Or, well, no, I'm looking at this commercial in Madison Square Garden. Kentucky and Michigan State, Duke and Kansas. So, yeah, I might be messing with it on Tuesday, too. But then after that, I saw the other day, like, Kentucky beat some team by like 100 points the other day. I don't know who the hell they were, but, they got it pushed all the way in. Let's close out this whole situation. This Donald Trump situation, you know, it's happening. And I hope everybody now has realized, you know, you've woken up. Man's going to take office on... What is it, January 20th? So the homie Barack got a couple months left. Did you see that meeting yesterday? And then the overall or whatever, wherever it was. And then Trump's got this bust of Martin Luther King over his shoulder. And you can almost look at Dr. King like, man, it's some bullshit. Man, it's, God, I thought something was about something new and good was about to happen. He mother then went way, way back. Awkward meeting. Like, I'm the dude, like, I don't like being in awkward situations, and the way I handle being in awkward situations, I just leave. This is why I couldn't be president, because like Barack gotta like keep on a face and put on for the country, because like if he panic and run around like middle fingers high F Trump, like it's gonna be a problem more than what it is, because folks is out here marching and, you know, doing that thing they do when they get mad and crying and all this kind of stuff. But Barack got to be, like, he's like the head coach. He got to be, have an even keel temperament, or, you know, the system might fall apart. But not me, man. You put me in that office, and I got to sit there. You telling me Trump coming? Yeah, Trump be sitting his ass there by himself. Me and the babies and the wifey would be somewhere at a pool or back in Hawaii somewhere where they be sitting there waiting on us, talking about how these Negroes is always late. Nah, we ain't late. We just ain't coming at all, cuz all that foolishness you said about me. I got some sound as well that I want to play at some point during the show from last night's the TNT crew, Ernie and Charles and Kenny and them. They had some thoughts on the election. And I really want to get you guys' take on it, because sometimes I can be jaded about things and I don't really have a lot of like faith and hope and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, I'm gonna need you guys to kind of like, you know, kind of come with me, listen to this stuff. I'm not sure when it'll be. Maybe I may play it while I'm talking to Rasta Root, get his opinion as well, or maybe after that in the final segment of the show. But it's, if you didn't hear it, Charles is talking about how he was disappointed. Kenny was talking about how, you know, essentially Donald Trump just said some things that are unforgivable, you know. And like, it's one of those, yeah, it's true. Like, you don't get to just be like, tell me that my moms and my wife and my niece and my sister and my mother-in-law and all these women that I love ain't crap. And then me be like, ah, you know what, now you the president, I'm good. Nah, dude, I'm not a forgiving person. Charles talking about we need to move on. The probably the most shocking thing that you're going to hear is that Ernie Johnson didn't even vote for. Well, I'm just going to say he didn't vote. You know what? And two, I've got time for my interview with Shaun Smith. So I'm going to let you guys hear Ernie Johnson right now. It's about 90 seconds long, so kind of just bear with me here. This is the One Mic with Big Mic show. I'm here on Spreaker.com. The Spreaker app. Tune in as well as the website onemicwithbigmike.com, and I'm streaming video live on Facebook. My Facebook page is the number one MICWITHBIGMIKE. Make sure you check it out. Hit the like button and share this with all your friends. Share this episode. Tell all your friends that you hear in this chat room. I am No Dose, Big L, Emmett, Danny. Tell your friends, man, to join in on the conversation. But here's Ernie Johnson from last night. I want to get you guys' thoughts on what he had to say.
When this campaign season started, I felt like I'd been dealt a bad hand. Had these couple of choices. And there were trust issues with Hillary Clinton I couldn't get past. And there was this inflammatory rhetoric from Donald Trump, which to me was incomprehensible and indefensible. I couldn't vote for either one. For the first time in going to the polls for 42 years, I hit the write-in button. And I voted for John Kasich. And I left knowing that John Kasich wasn't going to win, but I left with a clear conscience because I hadn't settled. Number two, I'm hopeful. I watched the video today at CNN on what was going on at the White House with Donald Trump, President Obama. I was hopeful and I was encouraged that there will be a difference between the President Trump and the campaigning Trump.
That's a reach.
I just hope that he's all in fixing the wounds in this country and the divides that separate this country. And I want to be part of that too. And for me to be part of it, I have to look in the mirror and I have to say, how am I going to be a better man? How am I going to be a better neighbor? How am I going to be a better citizen? How am I going to be a better American? How can I be a fountain and not a drain? I'm going to pray for Donald Trump. I'm going to pray for all those people right now who feel like they're on the outside looking in, who are afraid at this point. Pray for them too. In short, I'm praying for America. And I'm praying that one day we're going to look back and we're going to say, you know what? That Donald Trump presidency, that was all right. But I'm praying.
Yeah, man, that dude got more hope than anybody, because I don't have none of those feelings he got. You know, and here's the thing, like Big L saying he voted third party. I don't even think that's third party, right? Because like the Gary Johnson cat and the woman, they were like the third party, the Green Party and all that. He just went like out on his own. And like, here's my thing with that. Like, if you're going to do that, if you Ernie Johnson especially, like me doing that is one thing, but you're a dude that got an audience and you got Twitter followers and all this kind of stuff. Like, you could tell people before you do it, B. Like, don't keep that a secret. Like, look, man, I ain't voting for none of these dudes, man. I'm going to write in Gary Johnson. Y'all come with me. Let's do that. Let's get him in there or whatever. But like to be like, I'm going to be one of one on that. Nah, it's kind of like, that's kind of weird to me. But for most of what he's saying, like, I'm not a praying guy and all that. Cause I asked a question yesterday on Facebook. Like, why do people do that? Like, after something horrible happens, you say, pray for Haiti. Like, it would seem like it's too late. The damn storm has washed away the damn island. Praying ain't going to help them at all. Because if it would have, it probably would have helped in advance to do it. Like, don't let this damn hurricane hit Haiti. And then it hits it any damn way and blows all these damn people away. It's just, it's one of those things that's weird to me. I don't really understand. Maybe it's just a social media thing that, you know, it's the thing to say. My man Matt yesterday told me that. He said, yeah, it just sounds good. And all right, cool, whatever, I don't know. But Ernie said he's going to pray for y'all. He's going to pray for the country. One thing he said, you know, that something that I say on this show a lot. Just do your best, man. Like, do your thing. Be as good a person as you can be. You know, and usually I'm talking to black people when I say that, because I don't think systematically anything is going to change that's going to necessarily benefit us in this country. Like, the more and more I look around, I see what I term Wednesday as those crumbs that have been led back to slavery. You know what I mean? Like, the 13th Amendment thing really kind of just opened my eyes, man. Just this Electoral College thing, all those things are remnants from the darkest time in this country. And the white people in power in this country will not refuse to let them go. Like, if I know it, I ain't the smartest dude in the world. I know they know it. They know what the Electoral College is. It's fairness to slave owners. They know what the 13th Amendment is or isn't. It's not the abolishment of slavery. It's just, this is how you get you some slaves. Without saying they slaves. But no one in power is saying, you know what? We probably should not have this be this way anymore. So as long as those crumbs remain in society and they lead back to that time period, what kind of damn hope you want me to have? You know what I mean? Like, I'm just going to try to be a cool dude, stay out of peace, stay out of trouble. You know, when people, I find out that someone's in need and I can help them, I'm going to help them. You know what I mean? But other than that, I'm not finna go down to no streets marching with y'all and changing up my life because we got to do this. We got to band together and do what? All 13% of us, minus the ones that's locked up in jail, by the way, all 13% of us, let's band together. Come on, man. This election, it's just an eye-opener. For the people that surprised, I feel bad for y'all. You know, if you got people that surprised, you need to tell them, listen to my show more often. I'll take all that surprise out there. I'll preview all this dumb stuff. Like, the first time you see a dude, the first time you see George Zimmerman hunt a kid down, murder him in the streets, and then go home. Yeah. I don't need it to happen 10, 12 more times. The one time is enough for me to understand what time it is in America. Coming up in a couple of minutes, I'm going to talk to the big homie, Shaun Smith. I've never met Shaun, but when I saw him on TV last week, I think it was, and he just looked like he's a dude that liked to, like, cut up and be funny, and I told Renee, I was like, yeah, we got to get this dude on the team. And he smoked weed on the field while he was playing. Like, who you know has done that? No one. And guess where the dude that did it is going to be on my show. I'm going to ask him if there's anybody else. I ain't going to ask in the front on nobody, of course, because I don't play them games. Ain't no snitching around here. But I'm going to ask him if he had like a crew of guys that was like, you know what, let's go ahead and spark up before we go out here and bash heads together. So anyway, it's Shaun Smith. He played on a bunch of teams, so I can't really point to one team to mention him with, maybe the Kansas City Chiefs. And also, before I take this break, I think he played with Javon Belcher, a name that you guys hear a lot on this show. And so I'm going to ask him about that as well. It should be a fun conversation because this dude, he seems to be a hella silly dude. What up, Peter Quill? Just in time, brother. I'm about to take a break. About 90 seconds here. We're going to come back and kick it with the homie. Shaun Smith, former NFL defensive tackle. Don't forget, I'm right here on Spreaker.com, the Spreaker app. Also on TuneIn. And One Mic with BigMike.com every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday starting at 7 o'clock. So tell a friend to tell a friend to tell a damn friend.
Well, I have one question for you.
Do you or someone you know run a business that could benefit from additional exposure? The One Mic with Big Mike show is currently taking on new sponsors and advertisers. One Mic with Big Mike is currently syndicated across 8 different online platforms. And your company's name could be heard and seen across all 8 as well.
Let's get to work.
Please send all inquiries to Mike at OneMicWithBigMike.com. Thank you for listening. Thank you for your continued support.
All I need is One Mic.
Hi, I'm Layla Ali. I might be undefeated in professional boxing, but there's one problem even I can't fight alone. Childhood hunger. Over 17 million kids in America may not know where their next meal is coming from. That's 1 in 5 children. Yet billions of pounds of surplus food produced right here in America just get thrown out every year. That's more than enough to feed every last hungry child. That's why the Feeding America nationwide network of food banks gathers surplus food and gets it to hungry kids before it goes to waste. But they can't do it without your help. Join me in supporting Feeding America and your local food bank by going to feedingamerica.org. Together we can knock out hunger. Together we're Feeding America.
To help solve hunger in your community and to find your local food bank, visit feedingamerica.org. Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
And now, back to One Mic.
What are we waiting for? Let's get to it.
With Big Mike.
Yeah. Here we go, yo. Here we go, yo. So, yeah, man, this Saturday, Tribe Called Quest, brand new album's out tonight or today. We're going to talk to my man Shaun Smith, former NFL D tackle here in just a second. But at the top of the hour, we're going to talk to DJ Rasta Root, the manager, friend, DJ of A Tribe Called Quest and the late, great Fife Dog. Don't forget the show is heard live every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday here on Spreaker.com, the Spreaker app, as well as on TuneIn. And, of course, One Mic with BigMike.com. Jump on in this live interactive chat room, man. Also, hit me up on the text line at 404-902-8104. Or you can leave your comments below the live streaming video on Facebook. So right now, as I mentioned, you know, welcome in the big homie. His name is Shaun Smith. He's on Twitter at AutumnSJS90 and on Instagram at BigBuddy90. Y'all give it up one time. Shaun, what's happening, brother?
Man, what's going on, man? You doing all right, man?
I'm trying, brother. I'm trying. So the reason I wanted you on the show, there's something that I'm always talking about on this show, and I have been for years on a couple of other shows that I've been fortunate enough to do, and it's the marijuana situation. And I think, for myself, I think the NFL weed policy is total crap and stupid, and I think it's redundant and antiquated and all those things. Now, you had a pretty long NFL career. Let me ask you something, man. Like, how does your body feel? Because when I talk to my former NFL guests, that's one of the first things I want to know. Like, how do you feel physically now that the career has been done for a couple years?
Oh, man, my body hurts every day. Yeah. I mean, my low back hurts. My whole body hurts.
And you play, what, 9 years?
I played 10 years.
What was your concussion situation like, man? Like, how many certified concussions did you experience while playing in the NFL?
I can't really pinpoint how many because, on the way to make the league, you can't make the team in the tub.
My man.
In the trainer. So, at times, I know it's been plenty of times I done made a tackle and knock myself kind of dizzy just hitting them so hard, you know what I mean? Then also just taking on 600-plus pounds pretty much every play. So.
And see, that's what I tell people. Like, people tend to get enamored with those big hits in the middle of the field, those, collisions in the middle of the field. But I tell everybody, watch the running plays. Watch the linemen, the defense and the offensive linemen. Watch that and listen. Because now, because they got these big-ass boom microphones, you can hear, bah, bah, bah. I'm like, dude, those are the head injuries. That's what we really should be talking about. But the NFL, I'm going to ask you, you tell me. Does the NFL give a damn about your safety, bro?
It all depends what team you play for. I'll put it to you like that.
What you mean?
Because when you get hurt, you know, it all depends who you are. They're going to try to make sure you playing that next week. Whatever treatment it is, they're going to make sure you got to get to playing.
Gotcha. The other voice that you're hearing is former NFL D tackle Shaun Smith. Make sure you guys are following him on Twitter at Autumn SJS. We got to talk about your foundation here in just a second, too, my man. But the reason I saw you on Outside the Lines last week, or maybe the week before last, I forget when it was, but it caught my attention immediately that you actually smoked weed before you played. Before you actually played in the game. Now, was it just you, or did other people join you, or did they know about? Did other people know about it, or was it just something that you did on your own?
A little bit of both. There's other cats that do it. I'm gonna blow their spot and all that.
Nah, we won't do that.
I mean, I really care because you know my saying anyway is I just work with them cats anyway.
Word
I can count on my hand how many cats I fool with now that I'm not playing no more. You know what I mean? So, but on the real, there's a lot of cats that do it. You know, you would surprise some of these high-profile quarterbacks do it, man.
Yeah.
This what I knew was real. When I seen one day, I was in a club back home in New York, and I seen, man, Steve Nash blowing, man.
Word.
Steve Nash blowing. You know what I mean? Not to put the man out there like that, but, my man, you wouldn't think Steve Nash blew weed. You know what I mean?
Right.
I don't understand why guys smoke weed. You smoke weed because of the muscle. You'd rather, instead of taking pain pills and getting crazy thoughts and all the opiates and being, you know, want to commit suicide or getting addicted to the pills, weed mellows you out and also helps you.
Yeah.
With nausea, also cancer. It's a lot of things people be talking about it like it's a bad thing, but trust me, a lot of people do it.
Yeah, and I just actually mentioned that before you got on the show. I was like, people have this stigma around weed because the government has said for so long this is a Schedule I drug. It's harsher than heroin. It has no medical benefit. But now time is showing us and science has shown us that actually, and this is why I asked you about the concussions, bruh, because I forget what I was looking at. Oh, this show on Viceland called Weedicate. And they were talking about these cannabinoid receptors that are in your brain. And one of the doctors said, if I was an NFL player, he said, I wouldn't smoke the weed. But, you know, they have like the CBD, the stuff that doesn't get you high. He said, I would take CBD capsules before I went to every practice and every game. Because apparently the marijuana, the cannabis, it builds in a sort of insulation around your brain to help prevent getting concussions. Now, my ask to you in this situation is, if the NFL has a huge problem with concussions and lawsuits and all that, I'm not saying just say, go ahead, smoke as much weed as y'all want to as an organization, because, of course, there is a public perception to worry about. But why wouldn't, like
my man,
go ahead, I'm sorry, go ahead.
It's a public perception, but, man, you'd be surprised how many people in boxing say, man, I'm glad you spoke up about it.
My man.
But they scared to say something about it, man. And I can't blast people, but there's so many cats that are playing with the kids. A lot of people just, oh, yeah, man. Oh, yeah, you know, this, man. So happy you spoke, man. You said it right. You know what I mean? I'm not saying right. I'm just speaking the truth.
Yeah.
And that's the one thing about my 10-year career. I could probably still have been playing, you know, a little longer, but my mouth kind of got me in trouble and got blackballed. And, you know, undrafted free agent. I speak my mind, never hold my, you know, hold nothing back.
Yeah, and I could like I said, I could tell that by like watching you on Outside the Lines. I was like, this dude want to say more. There's stuff that he want to say, but the show seemed to be so buttoned up that you ain't get to like really let it ride. So I told my producer, I was like, nope, we gotta get that guy on my show because like, dude, you can say whatever the hell you want to on this show. Let's talk about that public perception that we just mentioned. How much responsibility do fans have in that? Because every time you hear, like today, Randy Gregory, apparently, he failed another test. And he came out and said it was because of weed. And the first thing fans want to do is, man, he's so damn stupid. Man, he's an idiot. Not realizing that maybe this kid, just like you said earlier, may be self-medicating. Maybe he don't want to be on pain pills and Oxycontin and Vicodin and all that stuff. But my question to you as a former player, how much responsibility do you think is in the fans' hands to start understanding more about this plant and not going with the status quo that, oh my God, it's a drug, people are going to get hooked, it's a gateway drug and all this damn foolishness? How much responsibility do fans have?
The fans have a lot, but also people in general have an effect on it. You know what I mean? Because at the end of the day, like I said, everybody do it. It's just, I don't know why they're so scared to speak up about it. Now that it's legal in a few states since the election, it's going to be crazy now. The fish is going to be everywhere. You might as well, the government just trying to find a way to figure out how to tax it, man.
Yeah, yeah. What are you doing about that? Like, I know a couple of players and a couple of basketball players are starting to put money into the legalized weed industry. Is that something that you're looking forward to coming up in the future?
Man, I just thought about it. I thought about getting me a dispensary, man. I know a couple of cats and they make good money. You know what I mean? I'm about money.
My man.
The rich get richer and the poor get poorer, man. That's just how it is. If you ain't surrounding yourself and trying to get better and get some more money, hey, can't take the pit.
That's what it is, man. Before we move on, tell me about your foundation, brother.
My foundation is not even Shaun Smith, 91 Ways Foundation, man. All I try to do is impact and empower today's youth, man. I promote literacy because a lot of people don't know. 1 out of 4 kids by the time they reach the third grade do not know how to read.
Wow.
You know what I mean? And I also promote and push childhood hunger because most kids only get to eat a meal in the beginning, in the morning, and at lunch at school. Other than that, they don't get to do nothing.
Man, I love that.
I mean, when they go home, they eat. You know.
The website. Go ahead. I'm sorry, brother. Go ahead.
The website is Shaun Smith, S-H-A-U-N, Smith, SMITH91WAYS.org, man. So always hit the click donate button and donate to the foundation. We got the turkey drive we got going on. Every year I try to feed at least 100 families.
My man.
And I've been doing it for the last 9 years. So, I mean, it's been a success. Everything's good. I'm blessed. I just try to get back when I can, be in these schools, and just try to give people a little life and, you know, give them hope and believe and keep their faith on.
That's some real stuff, man. Make sure you...
Besides my mental part, you know, mentally drained too. I have my good days and bad days. Don't let the persona of my Twitter fool people, man. Real life with me.
Yeah, you a wild kid. I saw, what was that, this morning? You was walking through Walmart in your bathrobe, cuz?
Yeah, man, I went to my yoga class, my robe. You know, I be going a few places, man. You know, hey, it's a robe. You know what I mean? I might be ready for reality TV, to be honest with you, some real shit. You know, but I gotta have that catchy name. I don't want the same typical show like everybody else.
Well,
like, this show right now, like my man Gary on. That's a good show. That's a real show.
What show?
The Gary Owen, the comedian, the white dude.
Gary Owens. Okay, the white dude. Yeah.
That's my man, yo. This show's a good show, man. There's a few good shows out there, but it ain't enough, though. You know what I mean?
That's what's up. Make sure you guys are following this cat on Twitter and Instagram so you can see some of the stuff that he's all about. At Autumn, SJS90, and on Instagram, at BigBuddy90. Now, you ended your career with the Chiefs in 2012, right?
Yeah, 2013, basically.
12-13. Now, there's something that I always mention to my listeners on this show. Like, anytime I hear this stuff in the NFL about, you know, the NFL's handling of domestic violence, you know what a name that never comes up? And I want to know if you know this guy, Javon Belcher. Did you know Javon Belcher?
Yeah, I played with him. Yeah. I mean, I pulled in the parking lot for the incident happened.
Wait, you what now? You pulled in the parking lot?
Just before everything was happening, I was just pulling into the complex.
For those of you who don't know, who haven't heard me talk about Javon Belcher, Javon Belcher is the Kansas City Chiefs player that killed his girlfriend and then drove down to the stadium, told his boss and his head coach thank you, and then killed himself in front of them. And I always bring it up when anything happens domestic violence wise in the NFL, to just call bull on the league, because like that happened and it was talked about and it went away. Then the Ray Rice thing happened. Then you see commercials with Chris Carter crying on the commercial and, oh, we care and enough is enough. And I keep saying, man, Jervon Belcher. Let me ask you, as a former player, how does the NFL, how do you feel like the NFL handles domestic violence, brother?
I think not just the NFL, the world, all the day is all about when the world and the NFL handle a situation only when it comes about the media. That's the only time it's awareness. Then you see a bunch of commercials, then you'll stop seeing commercials.
Yeah.
That's just what it is. It's a fight. Yeah, I mean, you just watch it and let it be. Being honest. Yeah. It's nothing you can do about it. And if people don't understand, domestic violence is just not physical. It's also, you know, words,
exactly,
all of that. Like it's violence. But, you know, it's not that. It could be words are abusive too. You know what I mean? So I don't think people understand that. But it is what it is. And people just got to be thankful and just get help. I mean, the NFL has programs. Don't get me wrong. They have some programs, but some guys don't be taking advantage of it.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not going to just bash the NFL. Shit, I played 10 years. I mean, evidently, it got me ahead in life.
Gotcha.
Mentally and everything. But, you know, mentally, playing in the NFL is a different world. But people don't understand, you're just a regular person at the end of the day. You try to be, once you start playing ball, you just try to still be a regular person. I'm human. I make mistakes just like the next man.
Right.
Or woman.
Why are the ratings so low this year? Why do you think they're so low? I know now you don't play anymore. You're a consumer like I am. You watch the game still because I see you tweet about them all the time. Tell me why you think the NFL ratings have dropped so drastically this year.
Because of the commissioner, man. There's no fun no more. There is no fun no more, man. I remember playing with a guy named Ocho Cinco, Chad Johnson.
Yeah.
It was fun. The game is fun. You know, you waiting to see what he's going to do for the touchdown. It's not easy to get a touchdown, period. People think it's easy. No, it's not. It's not. So when you get there, you want to celebrate. You want to, you know, have fun with it. Growing up as a little kid, that's what I used to see.
Why you think he's so rigid, or the league is so rigid on that kind of stuff? Because, like, yeah, I'm same with me, brother. We grew up watching guys, you know, show their ass in the end zone. But now, all of a sudden, anything is a 15-yard penalty. Like, why do you think it's become that rigid of a thing or an issue?
Because we're trying to be safety. Remember, safety. That's the biggest thing. Safety, they're trying to do it. The NFL is just sometimes full of shit.
Yeah.
And you know what I mean? Just like I tell people, there's loopholes in the system. So you take the good with the bad. You know, just hope it benefits you at the end of the day. Take advantage of what you can.
You know, I wanted to ask you, it just hit my mind again when you said there are loopholes in the system. I want to ask you how. Like, how did you come to smoke weed before you played? Like, I know most times you guys get to the facility, to the stadium, like a couple of hours early. So did you find a way to do it while you were at the facility, or were you able to do it before you got there?
Before I got to the stadium.
And it would still hold you, the feeling and the buzz would still hold you throughout the 3-hour game?
Yeah, for the most part, at least to a halftime. I had my mojo, I'd be in my zone, ready to go, and shit, be out there talking shit in the zone and just making plays.
Well, man, you got a wild story too, man. I like talking to dudes like you, the dudes that had to grind their way through, you know, undrafted cat, you mentioned playing 10 years from that. Every dude that I know personally was undrafted going into and played their time in the NFL, but it was only like a couple of years. And they would always tell me the stories of how you kind of got to just become, you got to get fortunate in some ways because the reps aren't there for you as an undrafted guy. Like, tell us a little bit about your story.
If you only get 5 reps, they better be 5 good fucking reps, because if not, it's a rep.
Oh, man. What was the time in your playing career, maybe even early in the playing career, where you was like, damn, these some grown men? Like, what was that, like, I'm in the NFL moment for you, if you remember it?
Say that again?
That like, damn, I'm in the NFL. Like, you went from South Carolina to where the Cowboys, right? Was there ever a moment in the NFL where you was like, damn, this is some real stuff now?
Yeah, as always. Before every game, I used to be like, yeah, I'm in the, you know.
No, I mean, like, did something happen? Like somebody, you went up against an offensive guard or tackle, and they just kind of gave it to you, and you was like, damn, this is a grown man I'm going up against. This ain't Charleston Southern no more.
Going up in practice, Larry Allen. Going against Larry Allen in practice.
Oh, damn, you was there then. Like, Larry Allen probably the strongest dude to ever play football, right?
Man, Larry Allen and Close Down Adams.
Probably two strongest dudes.
Yeah.
All right, last thing I got for you, man, it's Veterans Day. I want to give you an opportunity if you want to shout out any of the veterans in your life, any friends or family members that you want to shout out for Veterans Day, or just anybody, man, in general.
I want to shout out the man above God. But also just everybody, just love, man, going forward and getting ready to be for 2017, man. You know, my wife, my kids. I just wish everybody good luck in their future endeavors and everything they do, man. Just keep their faith.
My man. He is Shaun Smith, former NFL defensive tackle. Follow him on Twitter at Autumn. SJS90 on Instagram at BigBuddy90, and make sure you check out the 91 Ways Foundation. Shaun, Shaun Smith, Smith, 91ways.org. And when you get there, make sure you hit that little donate button, man. That man's trying to feed kids, trying to get kids reading on a proper level. All those good things that we want people to do for kids, he's doing it. Shaun, my man, I appreciate you agreeing to do this, and I appreciate your time, brother.
Appreciate it, man. Thanks.
Yeah, man, the homie blazed up, and then went to play football. And like I mentioned during the interview, you guys can do some research on this. There are these things called CBD receptors that are in your brain, and receptors. You hear the word receptor? It's able to receive the CBD that's in marijuana, and in form of like a protection around your brain when you are before you get like head contact, or your head contacts another object. The NFL is really, really missing out on this. And I didn't get to ask Shaun. I forgot to ask him about, you know, his dealings with Eugene Monroe. Eugene Monroe is an offensive tackle who I think last played. He retired after the Ravens cut him. And he's a guy who's a big advocate for medical marijuana use in the NFL, because if you guys don't know, like, these cats stop playing football. You heard Shaun mention it. These guys stop playing football and they're hooked on all these pain pills, and dudes want to, you know, suicidal, turn into like fiends. Guys go from, because you can't get the pills no more, like, guys be going to like heroin and all that kind of craziness. I don't know about you, but I don't know anybody smoked weed and was like, you know what I want next? Heroin. Now, I'm not saying it doesn't happen, but I'll say this. I don't believe, personally, that it happens because of marijuana. Like, people say, first is marijuana, next thing you know, bath salts, and then you're chewing somebody's damn face off. Nah, miss me with the craziness, man. I'm about to get me a weed man. I am. Get me a weed man. But, like, I watch all these weed shows. Like, if you guys ain't on Weedikit, the joint on Viceland, you gotta get on that. The homie Kreshner, we're gonna try to get him on the show. We've been trying to get him on the show, I guess I should say. The show is awesome, and it's very, very, very informative around a lot of different topics that all, you know, wind back up in the arena of marijuana. But the one thing that he talks about a lot, and you heard Shaun talk about it, that the government's looking for a way to tax it. To me, I was telling my wife this last night, I don't think it's that. The fact of the matter is, there's so many Negroes locked up for possession charges, like a lot. I want to say it's over 50% of the drug charges for black people is like BS possession charges. So now, like in California, I was telling her last night, now that it's illegal, it feel like if I'm a dude that's sitting in a jail cell right now because you pinch me with an ounce, and, you know, set my bail hella high so I couldn't get out, and I'm sitting in jail waiting on trial. Like, it served a reason for me that you got to let me out. You got to let me bounce, man, because you've just now admitted that the law that I'm in here for breaking was a stupid law. And because of that, I don't think nobody, these cats shouldn't be in jail. But I don't know about y'all. I ain't see no line coming out of the jails in California. Yeah, all them Negroes are still in there. Imagine that. Because you got caught at the wrong time. Yeah. This whole marijuana thing, it's gonna be very interesting to watch it happen. You know, I live down here in Georgia, Bible Belt as they call it, and all this kind of craziness. You know, every day, you know, kids that are having epileptic seizures that find themselves finding relief from cannabis oil. These people's parents are at their, what is it called, where they make the laws at in your city, you know what I'm talking about, the assembly. These folks are up in there with their kids, their sick kids, and all this kind of stuff, man, begging for the government to let them save their babies. That's the effing America that we live in. In about 5 minutes, a little over 5 minutes, I'm going to holler at the homie, DJ Rasta Root. He is the manager, friend. He's also the DJ for a Tribe Called Quest. They go in the late Fife Dog, and they're going to be on Saturday Night Live. Obviously, sans Fife, he passed away in March or whatnot, but they've come out with a new album today. For all my hip-hop heads, you might want to go ahead and cop that situation. They're going to be performing the album, and it's such a big deal, man. A dude that you don't see on TV no more for the last 10 years. The Chappelle Show, or Dave Chappelle left the Chappelle Show in like 06, because for those of you who don't realize, it's been that long, and he's going to make his return back to not only TV, but back to sketch comedy this weekend on Saturday Night Live. And I can't even remember the last time that I was like, man, I gotta watch Saturday Night Live this weekend. Because basically, if it's a hot, funny bit on Saturday Night Live, the next day somebody will be posting it on Facebook, or you'll catch it on YouTube or whatever. So I ain't never felt the need in the last, I don't know how many years, to be like, yeah, I'm gonna look at Saturday Night Live tonight. But I'm gonna watch it this weekend. What time it come on? It come on at like 11:30 after the news or before the news. I gotta check the whatever, the guide or whatever, but I'm gonna check that joint out, because this is a big move for hip-hop. So like I said, we'll talk to DJ Rasta. Let me check out what's going on here in this damn, well, nothing. Yeah, Peter Quill is right. It's time to legalize, you know. And you know, and part of my reason for it, because I'm not a smoker yet, I'm about to be though, working on it. Part of my reason is that, don't talk to me about the kids. Well, we got to protect the kids. All right, then. Alcohol. Cigarettes. Once you take that off the shelf, all right, I'll see where you at. I'll come with you. But in what I've read and the readings and the studies that I've seen, those two things, nicotine, cigarettes, and freaking alcohol, way more dangerous. Plenty more freaking deaths associated with both of them. You realize that there is zero deaths that can be linked directly between marijuana and somebody dying. Like if somebody gets like in a car accident and kills somebody in a car accident, if they've been smoking weed, there's always another substance. There's always like pills or alcohol or something there. But no deaths associated with someone smoking weed and either killing themselves or another person. Crazy, right? But meanwhile, drink up. Everybody get a drink. Every football game you watch this weekend, they're going to be telling you to get as much Bud Light and Michelob and whatever the hell else you can, and you freaking tequila. Don't smoke no weed, though. That's the end of civilization. Show ass out of here, man. Anyway, man, I'm going to take a break here and get my man Rasta Root on the line. We're going to chop it up about all this damn political stuff. You know, I got to get, because the last time I talked to him, we was talking about kids getting shot in the street by the police. And then now, you know, America served us up a big fat boo-boo sandwich again. And you know, just so happened, my man was so gracious enough to tell me, you know, okay, yeah, let's do the show tonight. So we're going to have him on here in just a second. I'm here on Spreaker, also on the Spreaker app. Tune in, and of course, onemikewithbigmike.com. Make sure you hit that little heart button, that heart icon, indicating that you like the show. And also, if you're trying to get inside this live interactive chat room, like the homie Peter, Big L, I am No Doze in this mug. Of course, Renee's up in this piece. You guys just got to click the little thought bubble icon on the streaming player. Boom, you're in the building. Also, if you don't get a chance to hear the entire show or the interview with Shaun Smith, don't worry. It's all on demand in English on all the four episodes or on the four outlets I've already mentioned, as well as on iTunes, iHeartRadio, Stitcher, Google Play Music, and, of course, YouTube, where you can catch the video and the audio. I'm streaming live video right now on my Facebook page, One Mike with Big Mike. Make sure you like that joint as well. I'm going to come back. Like I said, I'm going to talk to my man, Rasta Root.
Well, I have one question for you.
Do you or someone you know run a business that could benefit from additional exposure? The One Mike with Big Mike show is currently taking on new sponsors and advertisers. One Mike with Big Mike is currently syndicated across 8 different online platforms, and your company's name could be heard and seen across all 8 as well.
Let's get to work.
Please send all inquiries to Mike at onemikewithbigmike.com. Thank you for listening. Thank you for your continued support.
All I need is one mic.
We asked kids what it took to be a dad. This is what they had to say.
A father is always present. I mean, what real father figure can you have if they're not there?
In order to be a good dad, you need to love your son. You need to put gas in your car so you don't break down in the middle of nowhere. And you need to make them breakfast. Yep.
I mean, just to maybe play like a board game with me, or to just stay home and play some video games with me. Just to do like that one little thing is what I really look forward to.
I'm not asking him to be a perfect dad, but he should try.
He's just a constant force in my life.
There's no other type of love like a dad's love, because it's not comparable to anything else.
Take time to be a dad today. Call 877-4DAD-411 or visit fatherhood.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
One mic.
All I need is one mic.
What's the name of the show?
One mic with Big Mike.
You know, ain't nobody getting hurt, anybody. You know, there's no crime being committed.
And they say his style is too urban for the radio.
This is real life stuff that's happened to me.
Well, you know what?
You.
One mic with Big Mike.
I like to be able to do what I want to do.
A sports talk show.
But no subject matter is off limits.
Meek Mill's concert is not called the Hell Yeah I Bang Khloe Kardashian concert.
And now, your host.
Put your hands together for the one, the only.
Big Mike.
All I need is one mic.
Yep, the One Mic with Big Mike show here on a Friday, here on a Veterans Day Friday. Shout out to all my vets, man. Appreciate you guys for what you do, straight up. I'm here on Spreaker.com, the Spreaker app, as well as on TuneIn, and of course my website, onemikewithbigmike.com. Make sure you get involved in the show by texting me at 404-902-8104. Make sure you like me and follow me at the number one, MICWITHBIGMIKE. That's me across all social media platforms. Also, make sure you jump inside my live interactive chat room. Just going back to the conversation we just had in the last segment real quick before we move on to DJ Rasta Root. The homie Danny says, back in D.C., weed been legal for 2 years. It has changed the lives of some of the homies that were just floundering in the hood. Now they work for dispensaries or grow themselves. I got to say, I've seen nothing nothing but good so far, and I don't smoke. See, that's the problem in America. You start empowering these young black kids, you know what I mean, financially. Yeah, the whole dynamic gonna change. You know, white America can't have that. It must be crazy. Anyway, we gotta move on to the guest, to my guest, friend of the show, world renowned DJ, manager, friend, DJ for the super group A Tribe Called Quest, and of course the late great Fife Dawg. He's at DJ Rasta Root on social media. Make sure you check out his website as well, smokingshells.com. Hold on, let me get the applause going here. Now give it up. My man, Rasta Root.
What up, man? What's good?
What's happening, brother? How you been, brother? We hadn't spoke in a couple months, man. How you been?
I've been good, man. How about yourself?
I can't call it. You know, the world, apparently, people told me the world was going to end on Wednesday, but guess what? The sun came up. You know what I mean? And now here we are on Friday. So I don't know. I don't know what's happening. The last time we spoke, we were speaking about the police murdering black kids in the street. That had just happened. And now, as I just mentioned, here we are in the world of Trump, my man. So when you, I don't know if you stayed up all night on Tuesday or if you woke up on Wednesday and did what I did and saw everybody mad as hell on social media, the moment you found out what happened, what was DJ Rasta Root's reaction?
I mean, you know, it wasn't a moment for me because I saw it unfolding as I was watching the whole thing.
Yeah, yeah.
I was a little incredulous about it, but I had a feeling what the outcome was going to be just based on what I was seeing. And, you know, I realized that, you know, this thing is way bigger than Trump or Clinton. You know, there's somebody else pulling the puppet strings, and I'm not saying it was like, you know, anything shiesty or anything, but what we view as what control is not what's in control. So, you know, we're just kind of wandering around this country, you know, absorbing what they feed to us in the media or whatever, but there's a lot more going on behind the scenes.
Amen.
It's almost like watching a concert, and all you're seeing is the performers, but you have no idea what goes on to put on the production and who's backstage turning what lights on and off and pulling what, you know, pulling curtains and stuff like that. So I think about the movie, The Wizard of Oz or The Wiz, and that whole thing, you know
yeah.
what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
You seem pretty much back to me.
You sound like me, man. I tell my people who listen to the show all the time, man, the game is being played on a totally different level. And it's not even that we can't understand the game. We just don't even know what game's being played at all, my man.
Right.
Where you at right now? You in New York right now? I know you guys got the Saturday Night Live situation going on tomorrow. Are you up there right now?
I'm in Atlanta, but I'm heading to New York in the AM.
No doubt. Yeah.
Go there in the morning and I come back Sunday.
Oh, okay, you're coming back. You're not going to go keep heading up on up north? You're not going to do that number?
Not this time around. I got to prepare something before I can do that.
So, yeah, for you guys that don't know what we're talking about, Saturday Night Live tomorrow, as I mentioned, DJ Rasta Root, friends, manager, DJ for Tribe Called Quest, and, of course, the late, great Fife Dawg. Tribe Called Quest got a new album out today. We got it from here. Thank you for your service. Are they back from an 18-year hiatus, man? How damn old am I? Yeah. Jesus.
I know if you answer that question, I got to answer that question.
Right. You heard the album. I ain't heard it yet. I told the people that's going to be my workout soundtrack in the morning when I get up and hit the
right.
gym. That's what I'm going to be working out to. But you heard it, man. Give us the preview of the album, brother.
I mean, really, like, you know, I mean, it's funny because I was there the whole time they were recording, and I just couldn't say anything to anybody. So it was like one of the biggest secrets I had to keep.
No doubt.
Since November, December. So I heard the creation of the album. At the same time, I was lucky as a fan that by the time, you know, Fife had transitioned and I'd come back to Atlanta, that a lot had changed in the music, and they had, you know, some issues with samples and stuff. So they switched up a lot of the beats and stuff. So me hearing it, I was able to hear with a fresh pair of ears, which was really cool. So I got the experience, the behind the scenes part of it, but also the final product was a surprise for me. And overall, I love it. I mean, I love hearing Fife. I love having memories of when he was recording and what state of mind he was in. And that really, you know, brings peace to me and joy. And I know the fans hear that in his voice. And I think that's the most important part. And beyond that, these guys being able to have as many issues as they supposedly had,
yeah.
but be able to come together as a tribe and create this beautiful album was the biggest prize of all.
Talking about coming off of a hiatus, now tomorrow night, when we see Saturday Night Live, we won't only see Tribe Called Quest, of course, sans Fife Dawg, but we'll see Dave Chappelle. How did that come about? How did Dave Chappelle, was it a Tribe Called Quest move, or was it a Saturday Night Live move that got Dave Chappelle?
I think it was probably like a cooperative plan. You know, Dave Chappelle is a friend of Tip's.
Right.
Remember, Tip was on the Dave Chappelle show and
absolutely.
With the STDs, which is kind of funny. So, you know, they're friends, and I'm, you know, Dave is a great guy. He was there for the whole celebration. I got to meet him in Jersey for Fife celebration at Apollo, and I think he just has a, you know, an affinity for the group, and, you know, I think it's a great time for him to do his monologue.
Absolutely.
I think being that it's Tribe, and he's also a fan of Tribe, and Tribe is a fan of his, it's like the perfect, you know, the perfect situation. I talked to Jarobi, and he was saying that one of his, you know, bumps was, you know, please join me with the Tripod Quest and Dave Chappelle tomorrow on SNL, the blackest SNL you'll ever see. And that's just Dave's sense of humor. So it's appropriate. You know, I think people need a laugh. I think this album, for people in this country and all the world, it kind of put them at ease a little bit, you know, with the results of the election. People still were looking forward to the album, you know what I mean? And yeah. I think this performance and what it can do for people and their spirits and their morale is going to be great and amazing. So I'm really looking forward to experiencing and witnessing all that.
Tell me about the final track, The Donald. Now, apparently this was recorded long, long, long before now, obviously, but it seems so appropriate for now.
Whenever the nominations happened between the parties, mm-hmm. we were in Jersey when he was nominated. So, Fife wrote the verse, and there were some things related to politics, but Tip gave him the nickname Don Juice.
Okay.
And, you know, that's where the Donald Juice, and then they decided to name it the Donald because of Donald Trump, but it's also an ode to Fife and, you know, his kind of AKA, his new persona that he was kind of like stepping into the shoes of, just like he did, you know, Fife Dog in the early 90s.
Damn. Dude, Cass is just so creative. Like, I don't have creativity in me. I like, this is what I do, my man. I talk. Like, you know, I turn a microphone on,
right.
and I talk, and
right.
I just say ignorant stuff and stupid stuff, and hopefully people get a little bit entertained and a little bit informed. Mm-hmm. But when I hear stories like that, I look at the album covers, the Tribe Called Quest album cover, dude, I get blown away. I was like, I don't, my moms and my pops, you know, they ain't give me that. You know what I mean?
Right.
I'm talking right now to a world-renowned DJ. Dude, it actually dropped some knowledge on me the last time we talked about, like, real DJing, stuff that I had no idea about. So I definitely always take that with me. He's the manager, friend,
good, bro.
Tribe Called Quest, and the late Fife Dawg. Follow him on social media, you guys, at DJ Rasta Root, and make sure you check out the website, smokingshells.com. You also were a part of some letter writing on a website that I saw today, Oka Player, OKAPlayer.com.
Yes, OKAPlayer, yeah.
And you wrote a letter that I read, and it wasn't what I expected, my man. I was like, all right, maybe this dude was like, yeah, okay, this is my guy and all this kind of stuff. But you yourself, you know, you articulated some things that I don't know how to really describe what I read. Why don't you do it? Why don't you describe what's going to be in these letters? Like I said, you guys can go to OKAPlayer, OKAPlayer.com. There's a couple of letters from people writing letters thanking and commemorating the Tribe Called Quest. And because DJ Rasta Root is my guest and he wrote one, I think I should give up on trying to explain and let you do it.
I mean, you know, it's hard. It wasn't so much a hard letter to write, but Fife and I have played so many roles in each other's lives. You know, I went from like a fan before I even met him. I interviewed him in college. So it's been a weird like hip hop romance, if you will. You know what I mean? I kind of look at it like one of my most beloved groups end up becoming friends with one of the members once they were broken up. And then, you know, we kind of had like went through a lot of hard times. Him as a soloist, you know, me trying to find my way in music, and you know, we built this friendship that was kind of like unbreakable. We knew that no matter what happened, we had each other's back. You know what I mean? And in writing a letter for Tribe, I wanted to make sure people understood that, like, you know, I thank Tribe for giving me Fife, and I thank his mother, Cheryl Boyce Taylor, for giving me Malik. You know what I mean? Because there's two sides to him. So I wanted people to know the background of how I met him and, you know, the different points in time that I had interactions with him and his group, and then how it affected me up until meeting them. So regardless of him being my best friend or whatever, I still revere them as a group, and they did a lot for music at the time. They did a lot for people, definitely myself, and I just wanted to express that. Of course, we had a time limit as far as when I had to turn it in, as well as how long the letter was going to be. But, you know, I try to be as deep as I could be and share as much as I could that maybe people didn't know, and understand that, like, for every person that writes a letter, they pick 10 people, but literally anybody who's ever listened to the album can probably write a letter of their own, you
That's
know?
Absolutely true.
That would be totally distinct than mine or whoever else wrote a letter. So that was, mine was just one snapshot, one story of how Tribe affected somebody's life. That's all it is, you know?
And the one thing I kind of gleaned from it, the one question that I had in my mind that I definitely wanted to pose to you, and I don't know if you ever thought about this, like, who would Who would DJ Rasta Root be if he had never met Five Dog?
I mean, that's a good question. I think how I was raised, a couple ways. How I was raised is, you know, one thing is I believe things are written and things are the way they're supposed to be, you know? So had I not met him or his group, I wouldn't have known what it was like to have met them, so I wouldn't have missed them, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
I've always been one to always, no matter what I had going on, big or small, I always looked out for myself. I always knew that nothing was forever, and God forbid something happened, which unfortunately it did, that I would have to, you know, dust myself off and continue my growth and my life in this world and my path. And no matter what happened, I have to, at the end of the day, be able to take care of myself. Yeah. You know, so
I guess what I'm asking is, what did he add to your life that wouldn't be there? I guess that would have probably been the better way to phrase the question.
Sure. I think the experiences of, like, you know, of being around someone who from the age of 17, 18 was plucked from his hood and traveled the world and changed the world without even knowing he was changing the world.
Wow.
And it made me understand that you don't have to do all that to change the world per se, but your world could be your neighborhood, it could be your street, it could be your house. And it's whatever you do in that time you have and how you utilize your time that's going to affect and impact and motivate people. That's the change, you know what I mean? And that's, some people try hard to, like, make a huge difference in the world, but that's such a heavy task to do. Why not just pick a kid on your block and help them out? Why not pick, you know, an elderly lady and help her out, or your cousin or your sister, your mother, whatever? And in your own way, you're changing the world. You're changing your world, and you're adding on to a larger change in the world. So I always felt like I had to find my purpose here. And I think as much as he changed my life and affected my life, I'd like to believe,
absolutely,
you know, that he changed, that I changed his life. You know, we've had conversations, and he's had some really, like, introspective thoughts, and he's told me things about our friendship. And, you know, I go back to our last conversation. It was, like, the most purest conversation we'd ever had about just being friends, you know what I mean, and what that meant, and everything we had gone. This was the night before he passed away. Like, we had a really peaceful conversation. It was almost like a goodbye without knowing it was a goodbye, you know?
Man. Yeah, man, what you said also, man, is, you know, people need to hear that as well. It's like, yeah, the world is doing what it's doing, but you got the ability to change your circle, the things that are within your reach, exactly, as well, man. Good stuff.
Exactly.
Good stuff. You a sports
guy,
man?
And if you change somebody's life, who goes on to change someone else's life, you've also changed that second person's life. You know, it's like a chain letter. It keeps going and going.
Just reciprocated. You know? Are you a sports guy?
Yep.
I don't think I asked you that last time, because last time there was a lot of heavy stuff going on, so we didn't really talk about sports.
I like European, we call it football, you guys call it soccer. I like that. I'm definitely into that heavy, but not so much into, like, NFL or NBA or anything.
When you say we, what do you mean? We what? Give me some background on what the we is. We call it football.
We mean, because, you know, well, I don't know if you know this, but, like, growing up, I didn't grow up in this country.
I didn't know that.
I grew up in seven different countries, you know, Spain, Abu Dhabi, England, Holland, Brazil, Guatemala, Canada, Japan. So, you know, I moved here. It's the longest place I've lived, but I moved here as an adult. So growing up, I had a lot more connection with Europe, if you will,
right,
South America, Central America. So I say the we in that sense.
Got you. I didn't know that. Like, every time I talk to you, dude, it's like something, you know, I need to have you on the show more often. That way, you know, I can become a wiser, more knowledgeable person.
Hey, man, that's what it's about, man. If I get to change your world, then I'm changing the world. Absolutely.
There it is.
And same, it goes from you too, you know?
Absolutely, man. Speaking of knowledge, something that I didn't ask you last time, because the last time I asked you about the role of the DJ coming back into prominence with guys like Khaled and Drama and guys like that. But what I didn't ask you, because something that I don't know, when I see a song that says it's DJ Khaled featuring Chris Brown and 2 Chainz or whatever, what is the DJ's role? Is the DJ the de facto producer? Is he the arranger, the guy who arranges the talent? Like, what is DJ Khaled comes out with an album, but he's not rapping on it or singing on it or anything, but it's his album. What is the DJ's role in that dichotomy?
Right. Well, typically, you know, the natural progression for DJs is to go into production. So either you're able to press the buttons and create, you know, syncopated beats, or you can tell someone how to do it, or when you hear it, you know it. if when you hear it and you know it, that means you're more than likely going to bring producers into the fold to create, you know, sound beds for your album, and you pick them, and you say, that's a hit, that isn't a hit. You know, DJs that are experienced have an uncanny ability to pick songs they know are going to hit. It's just a fun thing we do. We say, that's going to be a single, that's going to be a video, that's not going to work. And sometimes you're right, sometimes you're wrong, but you can kind of sharpen your sword by doing it consistently. I think DJ Khaled, with his albums, I think he just has a slew of producers. He has the name, so he might give them some type of credit, or he might take credit for producing it, but more than likely there's other people producing the sound, and he just knows how to pick the records, sequence the albums, find the right artists for the features, and make it happen.
Got you. Wrapping up here right now with DJ Rasta Root, friend of the show, world-renowned DJ, manager, DJ for Tribe Called Quest, and the late, great Fife Dog, at DJ Rasta Root on social media. Make sure you check out the website, SmokingShells.com. And wrapping up here with him real quick, tell me once again about SmokingShells.com, DJ Rasta Root.
For sure. Smoking Shells is a, you know, as far as DJing and stuff, I wanted to give back to, you know, the art form that had given me, like, years of experience, the ability to travel all over the world, you know, in fact, meet Fife, all those kind of things. So I said, what can I do? I didn't say this deliberately, but it just kind of happened in my head. What can I do to give back to the culture? So I started doing some research and development on what gear I could get involved with that was fairly inexpensive to create and that I could market, and it could be a project of mine to make something that no one knew about, make people around the world start knowing about. So I created a turntable head shell that's a high-polished aluminum head shell, and you're able to, like, laser engrave your logo on there. It's funny you said that, because I just boxed up six Smoking Shells head shells for DJ Khaled, and they're going to be mailed off on Monday to him. So to me, it's about figuring out what moves DJs, you know, marketing that, and then kind of spreading the word about it, and then, you know, that's pretty much branding. So if I'm able to do this with my own product, I can probably be hired once it's successful to help somebody else push their product out. That's my goal.
Absolutely. So make sure you get your head shells from SmokingShells.com. You get them joints engraved and everything, man, personalized for you.
Sure.
Last thing I got for you, I want to ask you a question going back to what we started the conversation with. And there's kind of a statement that I make on the show, and I made it to you, about not knowing the game's being played and how the game's being played, and a lot of people not knowing how much money influences the policies that tend to negatively affect black people in this country. And one of the things we talked about last time, you said these cats, they sleep too much to make a difference. I'm paraphrasing, but you were talking about all you're doing is partying, and then you have to sleep all the damn time. And I always mention to my audience that while we celebrate so much bottle popping and making it rain and all this kind of stuff, people are putting money into getting policy passed that's putting our black asses in jail right and left for some of the most minor things in this world. My question to you is, what role do you feel like hip-hop as a culture can play moving forward into, I guess, starting to play the game a little bit?
I mean, I think people are going to get tired of partying to the extent they party. And they're going to get tired of, you know, shaming people on Instagram. They're going to get tired of flossing or what they have or don't have on Instagram. At some point, it's going to be so inundated with that, you know, people are going to be turned off by it. It's just a trend that's happening right now.
And okay.
We're you know, we're usually the trendsetters, but there's times that we actually are you know, hurtful to ourselves, based on how we portray ourselves, how we treat others of our kind, and it becomes this rabbit hole of just, like, incessant, like, pulling people down. And I think it's going to take a new generation of educated people to teach their children, you know, where we come from, where we've been, where we are, and where we are going to go, or where we need to go. It's not going to happen on Instagram. It's not going to happen just magically. There's going to have to be people that have to make sacrifices, you know, big sacrifices in their lives to help affect change. And again, it's going to have to happen on a microcosmic level, not necessarily on the macro.
Yeah.
So me doing this in my community, or me doing something locally, or you doing something locally, or you bringing awareness via your radio show, whatever, those are the little changes. You know, those are the, there's going to be those that are going to gravitate towards these changes because they're fed up or they have a thirst for knowledge. Right now, we just have a thirst or just a thirst for partying. But once that thirst for knowledge comes back and it's popular to be, it's cool to like be smart, I think it's going to make a difference. Right now, I don't think it's cool to be smart, unfortunately.
There it is. My brother, I always feel like I get better when I talk. Well, we've talked twice now, so both times I always feel like I've gotten better after talking to you. And I hope that my audience is experiencing what I experienced, man. You're a very insightful person.
I hope so, too, definitely.
And I appreciate you taking the time out to deal with, you know, somebody on my level, man, and coming on my show and you know, talking about your friend, Fife Dog, and the guys that you're involved in and what you guys are doing tomorrow. I want you to travel safe, homie. I hope everything goes as planned up in New York. I hope you guys have a great time. I'm going to be watching, man. You guys go up there and shut
Thank
it down.
Thank you. Appreciate you. Thanks for a great interview.
Thank you, brother.
Thank you, man.
There it is, man. DJ Rasta Root, friend of the show, man. You guys, I hope you MFers, man, just got some of that. You feel me? I hope you got some of that. He's the DJ manager friend for the great group, the Tribe Called Quest, and of course the late great Fife Dog. Follow him on Twitter, Instagram, all those things. DJ RASTAROOT. And if you're a DJ, you got some DJ buddies, tell them to get their head shells engraved and all that stuff from my man at smokingshells.com. Damn show flew by. I didn't talk about nothing today, did I? I mean, my guest did. Shout out to Shaun Smith. Shout out, of course, to DJ Rasta Root. Make sure you guys check out Saturday Night Live tomorrow. Dave Chappelle making his return to the world of sketch comedy. You know, Tribe Called Quest, unfortunately. Ah, dang it. You know I ain't asked him? Damn. Sorry, y'all. I feel like I let y'all down. I mean, I do it probably every night, but this time I ain't really want to. Or I wanted to make an effort not to. I wanted to ask him if we could anticipate seeing a Tribe Called Quest tour. You know what I mean? Like now, Cass is like, you know, Cass is throwing up holograms and all this kind of stuff. Fife Dog can still be a part of the damn tour, couldn't he? It's 2016. Freaking technology allow it, but because I'm an idiot and forgot, and I don't even think I put it on my sheet here. Because sometimes, I mean, I start talking to cats, and that's what I just start doing, is talking to them. Oh, I did put it on my sheet. Look at it. It's sitting right there looking at me. But I guess you guys have to do what all of us are going to do. Just, you know, keep your ears to the streets. And for all you heads, man, you hip-hop heads, you know, find out. I heard the other day that Eric B. and Rakim is going on tour. Anybody else hear that? Yeah, Eric B. and Rakim. I think Eric B., got on social media and was like, yep, it's official, they going on tour. That should be pretty ill, man. Unless hopefully they don't like overprice it or outprice it, but you know, for a cat like me, or I'm not really the damn you're an idiot, dude. The cats like me who don't really do concerts and all, that's something that I might partake in. I know though, just ask him on Twitter. I don't mean asking him for me. Like, if I wanted to do, I could, like, go to commercial and then text my man and ask him. But I wanted to ask him for you guys, man. I wanted him to answer it for you guys. That's the way these interviews work. You know what I mean? But thank you for the advice there, I Am No Doze. You're always on point, my man. Always there, ready to rock. Man, so the show's damn near over. We got another segment to go. We're going to get into this weekend. Got some basketball to watch. I'm watching Renee Squad, Mr. Tom to the Izzo, T to the Izzo. They down, what is that, 37-43 to this? That's not Arkansas, is it? That Arizona? That's Arizona. My eyes are so goddamn bad, shawty. Anyway, we're going to take a break here in just a second, come back, wrap the show up. I'm going to give you guys the NFL schedule, the games that you might want to, you know, check out in college football this weekend. I got some NBA stuff I want to get out of the way as well. And hopefully we can do it all in about 30 minutes. This is the One Mike with Big Mike show here on Spreaker.com. Oh, I forgot. I wanted to share with you guys the comments from Charles Barkley and Kenny Anderson. Not Kenny Anderson. Kenny Smith. Kenny Smith that they made last night regarding the election of, or the, yeah, Donald Trump being elected president. It just sounds funny to say it. That as well as on this day. Coming up next on the mic, on the One Mic with Big Mike show here on Spreaker.com, the Spreaker app. Tune in, of course, and One Mic with Big Mike.com. Make sure you guys are spreading the word, man. It is a grassroots movement, man, so I need you guys desperately. Spread the word, tell a friend to tell a friend to tell a friend. The show is also available on demand on all four of those outlets, as well as on iTunes, iHeartRadio, Stitcher, Google Play Music, and YouTube, where you can catch the video and the audio, the video that I'm streaming live right now on my Facebook page, which is at the number one, MICWITHBIGMIKE. Check it out. Like the page. All those good things, man. We shall return after this short break.
I only have one question for you.
Do you or someone you know run a business that could benefit from additional exposure? The One Mic with Big Mike show is currently taking on new sponsors and advertisers. One Mic with Big Mike is currently syndicated across 8 different online platforms. And your company's name could be heard and seen across all 8 as well.
Let's get to work.
Please send all inquiries to Mike at onemicwithbigmike.com. Thank you for listening. Thank you for your continued support. All I need is one mic.
So you see, son, good manners are very, very important. Someday, many years from now, when you're a grown-up, you'll be a man. And when you are, you should be a gentleman. Do you want me to go through it one more time?
Yes.
Yes, please.
Yes, please.
Exactly. Always say please, thank you, you're welcome, and excuse me. Sit up straight, hold doors open for ladies. If a door's shut, then knock first. Don't burp, don't swear, don't speak with your mouth full, don't reach across people's plates, keep your elbows off the table.
What table?
And don't interrupt. While we're at it, don't stare, don't use foul language, don't call people names, but do remember people's names. Always share your toys, play nice, and cover your mouth when you cough or sneeze. On the bus, give up your seat to anyone who has trouble standing. Bottom line, treat others the way you'd like to be treated. Got it?
Got it.
And stop picking your nose.
Most parenting is hard to do in just 2 minutes. But spending just 2 minutes twice a day making sure they brush their teeth is easier and could help save them from a lifetime of tooth pain. For fun 2-minute videos to watch while brushing, visit 2min2x.org. That's 2min2x.org. A message from the Partnership for Healthy Mouths, Healthy Lives, and the Ag Council.
And now back to One Mic with Big Mike.
And here we go!
Welcome back to a Friday, a Veterans Day Friday here on the One Mic with Big Mike show. I want to shout out to all the veterans out there, man. Everyone who served, everyone who, if you got family members that served, because those people are a part of it too, man. You know, the kids who got to give up their moms and their dads, you know, for the country. The wives that got to give up their husbands. It's real talk, man. So appreciate you guys for doing what you do. And appreciate you guys for ensuring that I don't have to do it, if I'm going to keep it real. The show is being heard live right now on Spreaker.com, S-P-R-E-A-K-E-R.com. Make sure you guys sign up for your free Spreaker accounts and follow One Mic with Big Mike on Spreaker. That way you can get an alert every time the show goes live. Spreaker also has an app. Speaking of apps, tune in. I'm on the TuneIn app live every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday as well. And on my website, OneMicWithBigMike.com. At the Trial Call Quest in the background. I got a new album out today, man, so you make sure you guys mess with it. Just had the big homie, DJ Rasta Root, guy who's all in the mix with A Tribe Called Quest, best friends with the late, great Fife Dog. Before that, talked to the big homie, Shaun Smith, former defensive tackle in the NFL, man who partakes in the stickiest of the icky, and he partook in it. Is that a word? He partook in it even before football game. Said my man said he got his mojo on, went out there. Now I gotta hit the little button. Spreaker makes you hit a little button for explicit language, because my man was dropping like some cuss words. So out there talking cash ish on his mojo, high for half the game, my man. And then he polyed that, by the way. Like, this is the other stupid thing about the whole weed argument. Like, Usain Bolt smokes weed, Josh Norman and Michael Phelps and Alden Smith, Marcel Darius, all these supreme athletes. These are the ones we know about, because if you listen to my man, Shaun Smith, it's like a hell of more. He walked up in the club and saw Steve Nash blowing trees. the young Canadian getting to it. But yeah, the argument that, like, it's some sort of inhibitor from life. Like, you can't have an active, a regular life. Yeah, miss me with the dumb. This dude polyed being an undrafted free agent, poly that into a 10-year NFL career. Please, I'm good. I'm about to get me some, dude. I'm about to find me a plug and get me some of that damn sativa or something. Hell, you say. Maybe that'll help me with this, with my creativity and these questions of the day. Which, by the way, the question of the day is, what level of pettiness would you accept from Seven Streeter? It's brought to us by SportsNewsAndBrews.com, my homie Rob Calloway's website. Just had a great conversation with him before the show. That's probably why I ain't prepped the way I should have prepped today. I was talking to the homeboy. But yeah, the question is, what level of pettiness? You know, they kept her from performing the national anthem a couple of weeks ago, and now they saying she can come back in December and do it. But like, me being me, I'm not that dude that's just gonna show back up in regular clothes or even show back up with that same We Matter jersey on. It's gotta be like way, way hella worse. You know what I mean? So that's the question. That should have been how the question was worded a little bit, but I can't avoid my own stupidity. So, you know, whatever. I'm doing it now. You can answer the question of the day by texting me at 404-902-8104. You can also get inside the live interactive chat room. Some of these damn idiots answered earlier. I think I Am No Dose was like, show up this two middle finger with a shirt that says F Trump and a smiley face emoji or something crazy. Yesterday, Renee was like, she just walk out there and like sing the first word and drop the mic and leave on some straight petty, I'm gonna piss everybody off type stuff. Yeah, stuff like I believe she should do something. Like something just like real, like reenact that scene from Martin where they was all sitting around a table wearing all black with a fake Rockwilder. Like do something like mad ignorant like that to just piss white people off. Speaking of pissing white people off, my man Rob Calloway said he might have something for y'all coming up shortly. He's he says, you know, it might be a transformation to the HBCU report. His show on Saturday mornings at 8, it might be a little bit of transformation. It might be some stuff he's going to do it that's going to make it hard to smile, like Tupac said. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Speaking of pissing white people off. Anyway, we started the show talking about your homie, everybody's favorite orange president, Donald Trump. And hopefully you guys have kind of calmed yourselves a little bit and just, you know, pull the whole wait and see thing, man. Let it play out. Like, I don't think he's gonna be a good president. I'm damn near sure he's not. But just let's wait and see how damn horrible he's gonna be. Before we get into all that stuff and these college football games and whatever else, let's go ahead and take a look back.
Now let's take a look back.
Day
on this day.
So damn hungry, man. On this day in 1946, the New York Knickerbockers, who eventually became the Knicks, played their first game at the Garden. New York lost that game, 78-68 to Chicago. On this day in 1981, Fernando Valenzuela of the Dodgers became the first pitcher to win not only the Rookie of the Damn Year, he won the Cy Young Award as well. On this day in 1990, the late and great DT, Derek Thomas of the Kansas City Chiefs, he set an NFL record when he had 7 sacks in a game against the Seahawks. That was, who was the quarterback? Dave Craig, I think, was the quarterback of that Seahawks team. And he could have gotten, I think they lost that game too, because Derek Thomas missed the eighth sack at the end of the game, and they ended up losing the game on that pass play. On this day in 1997, Roger Clemens of the Toronto Blue Jays at the time became the third major league player to win the Cy Young Award 4 times. Steroids. Ugh. On this day in 2002, Barry Lamar Bonds became the first major league baseball player to win the league's most valuable player 5 times. Steroids. Something stuck in my throat. Anyway, that is your final on this day of the week, your Veterans Day edition of On This Day. All right, getting back to the late chat hand. Did y'all see like Steve Kerr losing it and Stan Van Gundy and and Greg Popovich. These cats, these white cats, some of these white cats is mad surprised, man, that America is this racist. They like, I can't believe it. Evan Gundy was like, I can't believe, because you know, Hillary lost Michigan. Like, I can't believe when I walk up into the stadium, like, half of these people feel aligned with this guy. Yeah. Guess who can believe it? This guy. You coach basketball in a state where the government said it's okay to poison kids with water. How you surprised? Feel me? How, cuz? Hell out of here, dude. The Hawks, man. The Hawks gave the Cavs their first loss of the season the other day. I think they got a couple days off because they take on the 76ers tomorrow. They got some renovations going on to Phillips Arena. Try to make that thing a little bit more, you know, spruce it up a little bit. They got a D-League situation. Brand new practice squad going on down in College Park. Or College Park if you're not from here. They got a new D-League team that the team is buying, which is awesome. Because Carmelo Anthony, about a month ago, like right at the beginning of the season, Carmelo Anthony was talking about how as part of the new CBA negotiations, that needs to be a thing where a developmental league team is associated with every NFL, NBA team. That way, it's not when you get sent to the D-League, it's not seen as a punishment. It's actually seen as the team trying to develop these dudes. I think that's awesome what the Hawks doing. This new ownership group, so far, man. Yo, kudos, man. The team is doing well. What are they? Something in two or three or something like that. How about the Charlotte Hornets? Michael Jordan's squad is 6-1. Oh, man. What else is going to happen this year? What else, man? It's still early, I know. Dwayne Wade went back to Miami last night. And Miami, I don't think, regretted it at all. You know, they won the game. The Bulls won the game. But Dwayne Wade, he didn't play well. You know, they saw what they would have had he stayed in Miami. And Pat Riley was like, all right, I'm cool. We got 82 of these suckers. Yeah, we'll figure it out with Whiteside and whatever the little white point guard name is and the kid Winslow and all these cats. Not white point guard. He's foreign point guard. Charles Barkley ran color yesterday. He does it every now and then with Kevin McHale. Like, Charles Barkley, like, I know I bag on Charles Barkley on this show semi-frequently, but, like, he's an entertaining dude when it comes to that color commentator thing, because he's got, like, funny stories about other players. And he said yesterday that when a dude reach in, Rondo was right. You knocked the hell out of him. That's his little thing. And it's entertaining. It's like when he try to get, like, too smart. Like, his favorite phrase to start every statement with is, so you see here, what people don't understand is, so you want me to believe that you're the only one that understands the thing that's about to come out of your mouth. Like, what I'm telling you, what people don't understand is, yeah, all right, dude, calm down. Speaking of Charles Barkley, I played you guys earlier some sound from last night's pregame team with Shaq and Ernie and Kenny. And Kenny and Charles, Shaq had something to say too, but I didn't have time to record it. And so I'm going to let you guys hear, and if you're listening, you want to react to it, 404-902-8104, or if you're in the chat room, I want to get a sense of what you guys feel about this. Or even if you're my guys that are checking me out on the Facebook situation, my guys and girls checking me out on Facebook, you guys want to react, please, you know, do so below the video, Facebook video here on Facebook Live, One Mic with Big Mic. Here is, let me play the Kenny sound first. It's about a minute long.
I think the one thing is that you just can't be naive to think that anybody who voted for him is a racist or narcissist or anything other, or any kind of ism. But you still have to acknowledge that he made so many of those misogynistic, racist remarks. And that's what I think disheartening to the people who did not vote for him, like myself, is this disheartening, because it feels like he enabled the workers of iniquity. And I felt that the moral line for me, it wasn't about a Republican vote or a Democratic vote for me, Ernie. Obviously, it was about he had crossed a moral line ethically that regardless of the policies that I wanted to be in place, I couldn't be locked armed with. You know, I've been an NBA player and a black man for a long time, and I know how to take a loss. And I know how to get up from a loss and know. But when I'm misled or I feel abused in that process, then I'm going to feel a certain way. He has to make it inclusive, but it's very tough for him because, Shaq, I think this. It's kind of, I liken it to the guy who's a narcissist in high school and he wins the homecoming king. He really doesn't get humble after that. And so he has to change that direction and be more inclusive for sure.
You know, my mom always told me, when somebody tells you or shows you who they are, believe them. Like right now, you know what America, the stage America's in, from what I'm hearing from Ernie Johnson and now Kenny Smith, America's in a state of denial that this has even happened. And now, to make yourself feel better, people are looking towards their gods and their Jesuses and please change this man. Why would he change? This dude is, how is Donald Trump, 70 or something? What 70-year-old you know that's changing? You know, if you one of those people who got one of those racist-ass granddaddies that, like, call every white person cracker or hunky or something, one of those cats that you don't want to bring your white friends over during the holidays because you know granddaddy going to show out, one of those cats, what you think you could do to change him? Nothing. The only thing you got in your repertoire is, that's just granddaddy. Don't mind him. He lived in a different era. Yeah, same thing with Donald Trump. The Klan about to throw a damn victory rally for this dude. His daddy was buddy-buddy with the Klan. David Duke loved this dude. What are you going to change? I just hope that he'll bring forth unity. Get your man. Y'all crazy. This is how people get surprised, by the way. When people are bad, always assume that they're going to do the worst. Then if he doesn't, you're happy to be surprised. But if you're assuming that, you know what, he's going to get it together. Ernie Johnson said what at the beginning of the show? You know, President Trump is going to be different than the Trump that ran. Put yourself in his shoes. You just became the most, you just got the most coveted job in the world probably by being yourself. By being the asshole, by being the misogynist, by being the racist, by being the xenophobe, the homophobe. You just got to the top of the pyramid doing what you do. Why are you gonna change now? Why? This dude is always talking about winning. This is what I do. I win, I win, I win. You think he gonna stop doing what he did to win? Yeah, y'all drunk, B. Y'all drunk or high, bath salts, methamphetamine, something, cuz. And then finally, here's Charles Barkley's take on the situation. Like I said, you guys can react in the chat room, my live interactive chat room on Spreaker, the Spreaker app, or my website, onemikewithbigmike.com, or send me your reactions to 404-902-8104. And by the way, you can do this even if you're listening to the show on demand. If you're not listening live, you can still react. Like Big L sent me, messages, and I think I've responded to him. I don't know if Spreaker lets me do that, but I tried to. He sends me messages after the show is done if you listen to the show after the live version. So you guys can always text or comment on the show, and I'll get them. You can always do it on the Facebook situation as well. So here's Charles Barkley.
I was in shock. I'm not going to lie. I was totally surprised. That being said, you know, we got to move on. But like I say, it's over now. He's going to be the president of the United States. We have to respect the office, and we have to give him a chance. Everything he said in the past, that's water under the bridge. And we have to give him a chance, and we have to support him because he's the president of the United States of America.
When people say stuff like that, I can't call it anything but stupid. You know, one time me and Renee got into a back and forth about that one time. You know, her position was that you respect people no matter if they respect you or not. Not me. I love the people who love me. I respect the people who respect me. I don't play that game. It's water. Like, everything that he said or done is water under the bridge. Nah. How is it that easy to forgive just because a dude now holds a position? I remember my man was about to whoop his boss ass one time at this radio station because this dude told him that I can talk to you any way I want to. I've earned the right to talk to you any way I want to. That's the same mentality that you got, that some white dude gave you a title of program director on your name. So now you get to be disrespectful? All good, cuz. All good. Nah. I ain't got to respect nobody. I ain't got to respect no office or no damn president of nothing. I don't know how y'all feel about that. Some of y'all may feel like, well, it is the president, and you got to show it some sort of respect. Not the kid. Nope. This dude don't like black folks, so I don't like you. Because if you had noticed, if you hadn't seen me on Facebook Live, I am a black dude. You don't got no respect for women. I don't know about y'all. I came out of one. I'm married to one. My sister's raising one. My wife came out of one, too. Ain't no forgiveness in that. Ain't no, it's water under the bridge. Like, why do I have to wait now until he does something? Like, why can't I just wait until he do something good? You know what I mean? We got to give him a chance. No, cuz, it's on you to prove yourself. You prove that you not really that dude. I ain't giving your ass no damn benefit of no doubt. Kiss my black ass. The whole two, cuz. Yeah, they didn't. Ain't nobody give Barack no damn respect. And you know what, too? Shout out to you, Purves, man. My man, Rob Calloway. All you dudes that's, like, posting the naked pictures of homie's wifey. You some a-holes, man. They posted all the naked pictures of the new foreign first lady, man. God. Oh, man. This is like a comedy, man. It's like one of those... What's the kid's name? It's like one of those Seth Rogen comedies. You remember they went and killed Kim Jong-il or whatever the kid's name from North Korea? This is like one of those movies. The dumbest dude in the history of life can easily push the damn button to blow up the damn whole world. That's outstandingly stupid. Anyway, man, this weekend, like I said, we got some college basketball kicking off right now. Right now, I'm looking at Arizona and Michigan State on ESPN. They playing on one of those big-ass aircraft carriers, man, for Veterans Day. So, shout-out to those kids. Like I said, my man Deshaun Tate is big into the college basketball. Another friend of the show, Vashti Hurt, CarolinaBlitz.com. She and he are my two my college basketball go-tos, but yeah, it's way too early for me to care. Keep it real with you guys. This is way too early. I'm going to figure out who the names are. Who the freshmen, the good freshmen are, who the good players are supposed to be. And I'm going to go ahead and let it ride. Just watch highlights of it, be honest with you. Got a little college football jumping off this week as well. I told you guys earlier in the show, what you're looking for this week is only like major, major upsets. Let me give you the rundown right quick. South Carolina and Florida. The only reason South Carolina sucks, my man Shaun Smith went to South Carolina. I ain't get to ask him about his Gamecocks. I definitely wasn't going to ask him about his cocks. Bang. I didn't get a chance to ask him about his Gamecocks. But Florida needs these wins. You know, Kentucky's still right there because both of them lost last week. Terrible. Like, the SEC East should just be like the SEC Junior Varsity. It shouldn't even be called, like, it shouldn't even be associated with what Alabama and them do on the other side of the pendulum. Missouri. Georgia. South Carolina, please, terrible. But you can watch it because the game means something for one of the teams. Same thing for the next game that I'm going to mention, Kentucky and Tennessee. They got to go to Tennessee and play this game. Both games at noon, the first one at CBS, on CBS, the second one on the SEC Network. You got USC and Washington. Again, man, for you guys who haven't had a chance to check out this Washington squad, they're now number 4 in the rankings. After starting out as number 5, being undefeated, still undefeated. USC is USC, man. They're going to compete, but they haven't been as good as they've been in the past with the Pete Carroll teams and so forth and so on. But if you guys want to see some Pac-12 football, you know, we down here in SEC country, so many of y'all only believe the SEC exists. But if you want to see some good Pac-12 football, this should kind of wet your whistle a little bit. You got Michigan, just the upset that I'm talking about. Michigan and Iowa at 8 p.m. on ABC. That Iowa squad, last year they played real tough and hard-nosed football. This year, not so much. But if you're looking for a team that may be able to upset the top 14, one of the playoff teams, this is it. For my people around this neck of the woods, that Auburn team is just hanging around because they hanging around. They can pull off this win against Georgia this week. And then I don't know if it's next week or the week after. They got the Iron Bowl against Alabama. They really turned the corner. Petway, they got the quarterback, White. The defense is playing well. They've kind of turned the corner down in Auburn, so don't sleep. They probably going to mash it in against Georgia. They got to go between the hedges this weekend, but they probably going to mash it in against them cats. And then you got LSU and Arkansas, two top 25 matchups, or LSU being 25, and, of course, Arkansas being the last team in the top 25 at 25. Now, as far as the NFL goes, I'm going to give you these real quick. Last night, yeah, the Cleveland-Baltimore situation. Thursday night football, it's time to get rid of it. It's bad football, bad teams playing. Just get rid of it. The 1 o'clock slate goes like this: Kansas City at Carolina, Houston at Jacksonville, Denver at New Orleans. That should be a good one. New Orleans, for my Atlanta Falcons fans here in the A, they just hanging out. You know what I mean? Hanging around, winning a couple games here and there, waiting for the Falcons to lose a few. They got that Denver team that's struggling. Trevor Siemian's coming back down to earth. You know, John Elway's like, damn it, Brock. Brock's like, damn it, Brock. Brock Osweiler, I mean. He probably shouldn't have left. He probably should have stayed there and put in a position where he knew the system and all this kind of stuff. But that is what it is. You got that badass Rams team against that badass Jets team. Atlanta going to Philly. They're on the road at Philly. That Philly team is a very sneaky one. They score in a lot of different ways, defensively, special teams. They got the young quarterback. The Falcons still ain't known for that pass rush. They got a few more sacks than they had last year, but not a lot. Green Bay going out to take on DeMarco Murray and the Tennessee Titans. Minnesota trying to get off the snide. Sam Bradford has turned back into a damn pumpkin. They got to play that Washington Redskins team coming off a bye. Then the 4 o'clock slate goes Miami at San Diego, San Francisco at Arizona, Dallas and Pittsburgh. It's time for Ben Roethlisberger, 2 weeks off that knee injury, to show improvement. They're on a little bit of three-game slide. It's been a while since they lost four in a row, and that Dallas team, as we know, trending upward with Dak Prescott. No Tony Romo again. He won't be active this week, so Tony Romo watch will continue for those of you who are doing that thing. And I mentioned Randy Gregory facing another year suspension for smoking the wacky tobacco. Then Sunday night, you got Seattle and New England. Then Monday, you got Odell Beckham and the wide receiver matchup of Odell Beckham Jr. and Adriel Jeremiah Green. I'm kind of doing this thing here because in fast forward because I'm about to get up out of here. I've already said that. So this weekend, I mentioned college basketball starting. Did y'all see a story yesterday about the kid from Florida International University, this tight end, whose career ended, man, in a domestic violence situation? And if you hadn't heard about it, you probably hadn't, because there ain't a lot of outrage going on about it. And this is one of those things where, like, people can't afford to play, like, the whole double standard thing in this situation. This broad got into an argument with her boyfriend, this kid being her boyfriend, because he wasn't giving her enough attention. She's pregnant. This broad boiled water and poured it on my man's head, giving him, like, second, third-degree burns and all this kind of stuff, ending his football career. I saw his stats and all this kind of stuff. He looked to be a pretty good college tight end. But the problem is, a lot of people want to make jokes about this and, you know, where were the grits at and all this kind of stuff. But I only have to look at, like, when people say stupid stuff to me, like, there's never a reason to hit a woman. Yeah, what if she pour a hot freaking water on your ass? There's always a reason to hit some damn body. But in the reverse, had the reverse happened, everybody would have been, including me. But I'm falling all over myself on this too. I'm showing it the same amount of attention that I would have. And maybe even more, because a double standard can't exist in this. This broad she seriously hurt this dude and probably disfigured him. If he can't even play. I just wonder, man. I wonder about this, that kind of stuff. I'm the same dude that after, like, when the Ray Rice stuff was going on, before the video came on, I was the dude that was like, all right, everybody calm down, you know, calm down. And then you found out what really happened, but there was a reason to, you know, you found out, before even the tape, you found out that the story was that he just punched her. Unprovoked, he punched her for no damn reason. But then a couple weeks later, if you guys remember, there was that situation with Jay-Z and his sister-in-law, Solange, in the elevator. And for whatever reason, that was funny to everybody too. Now I was like, okay, what if there was no cameras in there? What if that big ass security dude went in there and Jay-Z just got fed up at this broad kicking him and clocked her ass? He would have been the devil in this situation. Look, man, keep your damn hands off people. That it's everybody. Didn't we all learn that in kindergarten? Keep your damn hands off people. But please believe, just cause you came out of your mama with a vagina, don't give you the right to assault me. You put your damn hands on me, I'm gonna put my hands back on you. I remember the first time I hit my daddy with that, cause I hit a girl when I was in third grade that hit me with a block, and then when he showed up in the principal's office trying to be mad, I was like, "You told me that anybody hit me, hit them back." If you could have seen both of these grown men looking at each other like, "Damn it, what are you gonna say? What are you gonna say?" Nothing. That's what. Game, set, match. That's gonna do it, man. For the Friday episode of the One Mike with Big Mike show, it was fun. It was a decent week, man. The week started for me this week on Wednesday, but you know, thank you guys for hollering at me. Thank you for real. The Wednesday show was on some. You guys came out for the Wednesday show, and I want to say how much I appreciate it and thank you. Thank you for the guys and girls who showed up in the chat room. I am No Doze, Big L, Peter Quill, of course, Renee Cooper, everybody who showed up in the situation on Facebook. I will not turn this music. Emmett, Danny, appreciate you guys, man. I'll be back on Monday. The homie Ben Troop will join me for Troop Talk. We missed him this week, but we'll be back. Matt Latosky will be back on Wednesday. The whole crew is back together, man, and we'll try to put together some more guests for you guys. Apparently, you like when we do that. Make sure I get everything out before I leave for the weekend. You guys enjoy your weekend. Don't worry about all this Trump stuff, man. Enjoy your weekend. Make sure you tell your friends about the One Mike with Big Mike show on Spreaker, the Spreaker app. Tune in, onemikewithbigmike.com, iTunes, iHeartRadio, Stitcher, Google Play Music, and of course YouTube, where you can catch the video and the audio. Also, make sure in the morning, Saturday morning, for all my people who are interested in what's going on in the world of HBCUs, check out the homie Rob Calloway in the HBCU report tomorrow morning on Spreaker at 8 a.m. Until Monday, ladies and gentlemen, you guys be safe, and I hope to see you back here in the chat room or somewhere on Monday. Have a good one.